So amazing. Now, the story of the campaign itself is very interesting. Burlington was essentially a one-party town. The Democrats had such a lock on City Hall. And also, there was so little difference between them and the GOP that the Republicans weren't even bothering to field a candidate. But Sanders noticed that in his previous quixotic statewide races, he'd actually vastly overperformed in the working-class neighborhoods of Burlington. An early indication, maybe, that fed-up working-class citizens were desperate for an anti-establishment alternative. So he decided to run, figuring out electoral politics on the fly, stunning the political establishment, and really, honestly, the entire nation. What really fascinated me, though, was what happened after he was elected. So there he was after this stunning upset as mayor of Burlington, and all of the powers that be, whether they were Republicans or Democrats, decided, in Sanders' words, that he was a fluke, that since they still had control of the Board of Aldermen, basically their city council, they could just obstruct him completely, keep him from accomplishing absolutely anything, and then everything could get back to normal. In words frequently applied these days to Donald Trump, he was an aberration. So the Board of Aldermen blocked all of his key appointments. They even blocked his secretary. He was forced to try to run the city with all of his predecessors' obstructionist people. In the interview, Sanders compares the situation to Trump having to run the government with all of Obama's cabinet members, which, of course, is more or less what Trump thinks has happened to him. But while Trump has collapsed into an endless stream of conspiracy mongering and Twitter grievances, Sanders actually figured out how to get around that obstruction and govern the city according to his values. So what did he do? Well, he got together some of his top supporters and formed essentially a shadow government to help craft and execute on ideas. He also relied directly on the people of the city, delegating power to neighborhood councils. Each borough was given its own budget that it could allocate independently to suit the needs of the community. So 1 year into his administration, 7 of the 13 aldermen were up for re-election in what Sanders describes as essentially a referendum on his administration. This was truly a do-or-die moment for him. Would his political revolution be upheld or rejected in Burlington? So Sanders fields his own slate of 5 candidates. He tells the New York Times that he works harder than he's ever worked in his life, knocking on almost literally every door of the city with the candidates by his side. And when all the votes are counted, 3 of Sanders' candidates have won outright, and 2 forced the incumbents into runoffs. The remaining Democrats were actually forced to team up with the Republicans in order to keep control of the board. It was the Burlington equivalent of Chuck Schumer voting for Mitch McConnell for majority leader. But perhaps most significantly, in 1 year's time, Sanders doubled voter turnout, dramatically increasing the level of popular participation and bringing the citizens back into engagement with their city government. Sanders could no longer be written off as a fluke, but rather a force in his own right with a base of power independent from any political party. He then went on to win re-election 3 times, including once against a candidate who was backed by both major parties because, you know, the one thing that brings establishment Democrats and Republicans together is their commitment to defeating anyone with their own working class base of support. He told the New York Times, "What that tells me is that if government does respond to the needs of working people, they will come out and participate." It's a simple statement, but one at such odds with the suppression, manipulation, caricature, and derision that working people are typically subjected to. To me, this interview was so revealing because you can see all of the parallels with his political philosophy and theory of change today. He has faith in this idea of a political revolution because he's done it and he's seen it.